Welcome, let's talk about the GS Paper 1 2019 solutions. Now the questions this time were very very direct. Most of those were directly from NCERT. So if you have been following NCERT thoroughly, these kind of questions were very 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 easy to answer. The only key thing that you need to keep in mind is presentation of your answer. Now the question here talks about highlighting Central Asia and Greco-Bactrian elements in Gandhara style. So first of all, you have to explain what is Gandhara style. Classify this under the two features, the features that were derived from Greco-Bactrian and the features that were actually derived from the Central Asian side. Now, as we all know, Gandhara style was part of your NCERT class 11th Indian culture book. Okay, so the Indian culture book of NCERT basically talks about this topic in detail. Now, what are the major features that were borrowed from Greco-Bactrian? If we focus on Greco-Bactrian, it was the anthropogenic features that were depicted. So, human figures, human faces, significance of Buddha being represented as a human figure, then wavy hairs with knot on the top and facial features, third eye were some of the common features that were classic characters of Greco-Bactrian. When it comes to Central Asian type, most of were the formations, the art formations in front of the domes, the temples, the kind of garland creations that were seeing, the garments that were worn, and a kind of symbolic expression of human figures was some of the key aspects that were focused under Central Asian. So how these two differ? What was the major feature that was taken into account with Greco-Bactrian, with Central Asian? And then you also had the West Asian style. Now West Asian talked about conical caps that were there, talked about worship of fire as in the case of Iranian culture, focusing on naturalistic features of human life. So those things are the things that you have to keep into highlight. Now, 1857 uprising, it was the first revolt that was taking place as a leading path for the independence movement in India. Now, this uprising witnessed more or less 40 major and hundreds of minor rebellions that took place across the country. Now, to better classify this, we could classify this as either the tribal uprisings that took place or the peasants movement. Now, the tribal uprising, we have covered a lot in class 7th NCERT history. So, that is where you have to go back and check out. So, we focused on the Bhil uprising, the Santhal uprising, focused on the Khol uprisings. When it comes to peasant movements, you had the Fakir revolt, Raja Chet Singh revolt in the regions of Awadh. In the regions of Odisha, you had the Paika rebellion that took place. Similarly, Ferazi in the regions of Eastern Bengal, in the vicinities of present-day Bangladesh area. So those were the kind of peasant revolts that took place. Again, there were revolts from agricultural laborers. Indigo revolution was one of the major revolution that was focused on. So all these smaller revolutions that we focus on were part of the combined force that acted for the 1857 revolution, and this was one of the revolutions that was the founding stone for our independence movement that further took place. So you have to better classify and categorize your answer in order to bring in the best responses from the examinee. Now examiner, sorry, the next is examine the linkage between the 19th century Indian Renaissance and emergence of national identity. Now, impact of modern education, Western culture, how the consciousness of the foreign power got defeated, the revolution in the educational system that was brought about, all were the founding stones for the Indian Renaissance. Now, Indian Renaissance talked about social reformers, mainly abolition of, let's say, sati pratha, abolition of dowry, female education, talking about removal of untouchability. So all those are very much consonant with the developments that were taking place as a socio-economic reformer. So most of the socio-economic reformers, be it Dayanand Saraswati, be it Ishwarchandra Vidyasagar, were some of the major figures that were brought into light, and that led to emergence of national identity, which was much more on a secular basis, much more on a socialist basis, and evolution of new forms, new ideas. It was not just confined to social upbringing, but it was also including the ideas of bringing in more literature changes, talking about classical music, how classical music superseded the other forms of Western music, the inputs from, let's say, Bankim Chandra Chattopadhyay, talking about the rhythms from Tagore, Iqbal. Those were some of the ideas that brought in a national identity. The next was assessing the impact of global warming on coral reef. Now, we have already covered this in detail. Just a quick understanding of the concept. In a question like this, we have to briefly explain what are corals, what is the sensitive range under which they can survive, what are the features that led to the depletion of corals, or basically the bleaching of corals, we could say. Now, temperature rise, one of the major features, what we say, affect the corals, because corals have a very narrow zone under which they can maintain the temperature variations. Beyond that, bleaching would occur immediately. If there is an infectious disease outbreak, then again it would be harmful. If you look back onto 2016-17, there was nearly 50% reduction in the corals that was seen, and this 50% reduction was a significant reduction in the corals, and therefore there was an impact on, or an immediate need to assess where actually the things were going wrong. So global warming came out to be one of the major reasons for that. Now global warming, because of that, you have changes in the storm patterns, changes in the ecosystem that is seen. You also have changes in the precipitation, rainfall phenomena, and all these directly and indirectly affect the life of the coral. Again, you have the changes in the ocean currents, ocean getting acidic, the pH levels changing into the oceans. So what is the way forward? So Wilkinson's report is one of the major reports that we have to focus on. And then we have much more remedies and causes that we have discussed in this lecture. So you can just go back and check that out. The next is the causes for depletion of mangrove and importance in maintaining the coastal ecology. So what are mangroves? Mangroves are mainly found in the regions where you have shallow waters, not so deep waters, and the main idea is they have nearly 2 lakh square kilometers of the area which is covered with nematophores, or breathing roots, what we say. So those are also called as aerial roots. The roots come out and take the oxygen. The whole process, why these mangroves are so important for the ecosystem, is they prevent the silt from entering into the ocean, and as a result, the level of the sediments in the ocean does not increase, because if that keeps on increasing, what would happen? The sea level would rise up at a very fast pace. So that is one of the major things that we need to understand. Again, it is one of the most productive terrestrial ecosystem. They act as water filters, water purifiers. They also act as shock absorbers. So any kind of high tide or wave coming into the region could be protected because of the mangroves that are growing in. Lot of scientific management practices and local community conservation practices have given mangroves a good thrust. Again, the most important thing is what causes the depletion. So if you are damming the rivers, if you are over harvesting, there is lot of pollution, climate change, or cutting and clearing of the forest, that would lead to depletion of the mangroves. Now the most interesting part was, this was one of the topics that we had discussed on answer writing for UPSC mains, how to write your answers, and interestingly this was part of your question paper. The details you can find in this lecture. Again, the next topic is the strategy of regional resource-based manufacturing. Now, be very, very careful what the question is asking. The question is asking about development of regional centers. So, let's say you have textile center being developed here, jute sector being developed here. Now, this is a regional resource-based manufacturing. You have lot of cotton production, so textile industries. Lot of jute production, so jute industries. Now, what are the challenges and how you can cope this up? So, you have numerous government employment strategies which have come off recent, which are part of your Yojana and Kurukshetra every time. So, you can give a thrust to your answer with those, but that does not form your answer in totality. So, what you have to focus on is how local resources can be procured. The reduction in the transportation cost could be borne up. Industrial localization could be given preference. You have more variety of consumer demand and consumer goods that could be produced. Local expertise could be hired for the same. The semi-skilled, unskilled labor present in that region could be better utilized. They would have less cost in migrating, and therefore you could have cheaper labor that could be seen. Again, you have the vision plans for the various states. So, let's say Odisha had its vision plan. You had Gujarat having its vision plan. So, each of these states, whatsoever states are there, and having their vision plan, have certain developmental methodology for giving a thrust to the SEZs, to the small-scale industries, agro-based industries. Similarly, the Northeast Industrial Cluster that has been in focus a lot these days, a lot of small manufacturing agro-based activities have developed. Since the time you have bamboo being shifted to the category of grass, you have lots and lots of bamboo products, bamboo industries coming up. Bamboo has now been even under the export regime. So, tribal products, we could say minor forest produce, are some of the things that can really, really change the local economy, give a thrust to not only the industrial sector but also tourism sector in those areas, as we have seen in the cases of Zero in Arunachal Pradesh. So those are the things that we need to highlight while bringing employment. Rural tourism, bringing in B&B, bread and breakfast, in most of the rural areas where the households themselves can rent out a part of their houses for the tourism purpose, is another kind of incentive that could be taken into account. The next is localization of agro-based food processing industries in Northwest India. Now again, Northwest India is one of the major hubs for agricultural production. You have a good feature. That's the geographical characteristics, we could say. A lot of availability of raw material that is seen. A lot of marketing strategies that could be taken into account. The socio-economic setup promotes gender parity, and therefore you have more development in the states which have higher per capita income, higher PPP, higher per capita income. And then you have capacity building, more of research and development, government aids that has been brought about. For example, soil health card, talking about the level of fertility in the soil, infrastructural facility, better marketing network. So ENAM is again one of the objectives that we focus on. But the idea is, whatever is being produced locally in the Northwest area could be brought into processed forms, and these processed forms, since it has value addition, it could be sold into market at a better price. The next question talks about Indian society is unique in sustaining its own culture. Definitely yes, because we have a cosmic vision. You have a lot of integrity that is seen across cultures. We have a kind of secular nation where we are talking about stability, continued development. There is unity in diversity. Caste system is slowly and gradually abolishing. So all this is where we are focusing on accommodation and assimilation of various cultures within the culture. And there is where we say unity in diversity in the nation. So those are the things that you have to highlight while answering a question like this. The next question is, empowering women is a key to controlling the population growth. Now we have two of the editions of Kurukshetra and Yojana, which focused on women empowerment. Now definitely, so far, the years that were there, you had women that was considered as financially weaker section, and therefore, family planning, health services was the least priority. As in when you had the financial scenario that stabilized and got strengthened, women started to move out for work. There was a removal of large scale illiteracy, higher education, higher access to social media, talking about the issues that are related to uneducated families, higher fertility rate, drawbacks of higher population, slowly and gradually brought in more awareness among the people, and sensitizing about the issue of population growth, family planning was one of the major ideas that was brought about. And with women empowerment, definitely population growth could be controlled at a much farther pace. Now, since you would be appearing next year, you could use provisional 2020 census as one of the data to understand how the scenario has been changing. So whenever you have a question like this, try to substantiate your answers with much more statistics, much more factual information. You can simply take out the proportion of rural women and the urban women, and the employment rate in the rural scenario, urban scenario, vis-a-vis number of child per women in a rural scenario and an urban scenario, and then compare and contrast the scenarios to better substantiate your answer. The last question in this set is, what are the challenges to our cultural practices in the name of secularism? Now, whenever we are talking about secularism, there are certain challenges that come up. Now, these could be constitutional changes, where, let's say, talking about the CAA as of now is one of the issues that come up. Then you have issues related to right to equality, talking about animal rights, talking about Jallikattu. We are focusing on the harmful cultural rights practices that were taken into account. For example, the Dawoodi community, that was there was a ban that was put in 2018. Now, that is on the constitutional side. Coming on to individualistic perception. An individualistic perception is because there is restrictions to certain food choices, restrictions to certain practices that need to be followed, certain fundamentalist, pro-fundamentalist or anti-secular movements that are part of the nation. And again, there is kind of bringing secularism as a kind of aesthetic move. That is where you have a lot of challenges. So bringing in across religion a uniformity to work together is where we can focus on curbing all kind of challenges. And it's through a behavioral change, it's through a mental change that needs to come up through generations. Unless and until that comes up, there is less probability that issues like this will not crop up in future. So those were some of the major elements that we have discussed in these 10 questions. We would be continuing with the next 10 questions in the next class. So if you have any doubts, any questions, any queries related to answer writing, feel free to comment us. And also, all these answers, a kind of draft is available at ExamRaise past papers. So you can just go out and check out the past papers where you have a kind of outline that is drafted for each of the answers. Have a wonderful evening.